Welcome to the PrePost Film Review. I'm Matt Stevenson.
And I'm Bill Wilkins.
That's a pretty good impression of old Bill.
Thanks. And I'm John Asquith. So the way the podcast works is we talk about a film over two separate time periods. The first section you'll hear is where we talk about a trailer for a film. In this case, we're going to be talking about The Conjuring 2, the sequel to The Conjuring, if you couldn't guess. So we'll be talking about the trailer first, and that will be spoiler-free because we haven't seen the movie, so we'll just offer up some predictions, some general thoughts on what we're expecting, things like that. And then we come back, and after we've seen the film, we record a review of the film. And we jump straight into spoilers then, so don't listen to that section if you haven't seen the movie, because you'll get spoiled. But without any further ado, let's go into our trailer thoughts for The Conjuring 2.
This is my home. Get out now.
No, this is not your house. Now, what's your name?
My name is Bill Wilkins. And I'm 72 years old.
What do you make of that voice?
Sounds confused. Is he senile?
The voice on this tape is coming from an 11-year-old girl. They're calling it England's Amityville. There is a family that desperately needs our help.
After everything we've seen, there isn't much that rattles either of us anymore. But this one still haunts me.
Ooh, it's getting a bit chilly in here from all the spookiness, man.
It is very spooky.
We've just watched the trailer for The Conjuring 2, and I didn't see it at the theater because I was a big baby boy who's scared.
So now we're forcing you to see part two of the cinema to make up for it.
That's right, exactly. Yeah, I'm curious what you think of this one, and maybe, Jen, just quickly what you thought of the first film as well.
I really liked the first film. I did think it was a tad overrated. I think people went a little bit bananas for it, and it wasn't as amazing or as scary as people thought. I mean, it was. Like, it was very well made, and I did really enjoy kind of James Wan's stylistic throwbacks to kind of 70s horror films, and there was lots of really slow zooms, which was really cool, particularly in the beginning of the film. I did think it sort of went off the rails a bit towards the end, and then the third act became a bit conventional for my tastes and lost me a little bit. But overall, I enjoyed it, and one of the better horror films to come out in recent years. So I guess I'm mildly excited for this one. I think the trailer looks interesting. I didn't know it was set in the UK, so that's kind of a cool twist. I like that they're setting it somewhere different. Just in a normal, like a general horror trailer thing that I hate is the way that they always try and claim that it's based on true stories. It just rubs me up the wrong way and annoys the hell out of me. So I dislike that about the trailer. But in general, I think it looks good. I don't know, it's a bit hard to tell. Some of the scares do feel quite familiar. You can sort of feel the beats of them and you know what's coming, like the scene where she's looking in the mirror and looking behind her and looking in the... Like, it's effective, but it's nothing new. Similarly, like that... Actually, the one that did get me was the creepy old man sort of like appearing out of the darkness after all the crucifixes had turned upside down. I thought that was pretty good. So yeah, I don't know. I guess from the trailer, I can't see much of the kind of old school filmmaking style, but I don't think that's what they're going to push in the marketing, because that's not the schlocky stuff that's going to get the mass audiences into cinemas. So I'm hoping that that's in the final film itself. I do, however, think that the trailer is pretty spoilerific. Not that I think there's going to be a big plot twist, but you kind of see the whole flow of the film and exactly what the case is that are investigating, what's happening with the girl, then the whole thing about her having a premonition about the death of the husband or whatever she was talking about. Like, it feels like it shows us way too much. We didn't need to see all that sort of stuff. But yeah, I don't know. Overall, reasonably excited, I think. I'm hoping it'll be good. What about you?
Yeah, I think I'm sort of on the same page. I was actually a little bit disappointed by that trailer. Because I did really like the first film. I agree that it was overrated a little bit, but still extremely well made. And like you said, I loved the kind of old school cinematography and stuff that was there for most of the movie. And as you said, that was the biggest thing that stood out to me in this trailer was it looks very modern in terms of how it's shot.
Yeah.
And, executed, and I hope that's a trick of the trailer, because it's kind of strange, you know. James Wan has this two horror franchises in currently in The Conjuring and Insidious.
Oh yeah.
And I felt like the difference was Insidious was very much a modern horror sort of thing, and The Conjuring was more of a throwback, which I way preferred.
Yeah.
So I hope they've kept that for the second film. Yeah, I don't have much more to add. I pretty much just agree with you. I think the trailer gives away a lot. Some of the scares don't look as inventive, maybe, as the first. I mean, that the trailer for the first Conjuring with the clapping and everything
that was really so effective. Yeah.
Effective. There's nothing like that going on here. I guess the closest thing is that mirror shot, which, as you said, we've seen before many, many times. So. Yeah. I'm sure it'll be effective in the moment, but I'm a bit worried that it won't quite live up to the kind of nicely crafted filmmaking of the first one.
Yeah.
But it'll still be well made, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so too. I did think, like, I'm not one to, you know, laugh at horror films, and it usually annoys me when people make fun, you know, like you're in a cinema and laughing at stuff. But that moment when she opens the door and the little girl's face is like in the between the pipes, going like,
that
genuinely just made me laugh. Like, it looked funny.
Yeah. I agree with that. We'll see.
We'll see.
Does it feel like the voice is coming from inside you?
More like it's coming from behind me. Like I'm being used.
Janet, are you all right?
Stop calling me Janet.
She's such a good girl. What's it wrong with her?
An oppressing spirit will try to force you to commit the ultimate sin.
And what's that?
Murder? Suicide? Or both?
You believe us, don't you?
Sensing a presence?
I'm not sensing anything.
All I can sense is their own fear.
So, here we are with our crucifixes, John, getting ready to banish some demons after seeing The Conjuring 2. So, I'm curious, given that we both enjoyed the first film, and in particular the sort of old school filmmaking style that James Wan used, I'm curious to hear if you enjoyed the second one as much and thought the filmmaking style was as effective this time around.
Interesting. I did really enjoy this movie, actually. I thought it was a really, really solid horror film. Very well crafted. Like, James Wan just has a sort of confidence when it comes to this sort of genre, because it's just like mainly what he does, it seems. Yeah. But because he keeps coming back to it, it makes me feel like he has a real passion and he really wants to like think of interesting and fun ways to scare people through cinema. And I really like that. I like that he's like accumulating this bag of like cinematic tricks for scaring people. And, you know, some of them are jump scares. He's definitely not afraid to do that. But he is very good at building just general dread and tension and like just very slow zooms or long takes in certain areas. I think this movie, he kind of did do away with the 70s style of filmmaking, though. I think this feels a lot more like modern in terms of like technically how it's shot and everything.
Mm-hmm.
There's some of the, well, there's like, I guess, because we jump straight into spoilers, like towards the end there is like some CG crooked man stuff.
Yeah.
Which I really enjoyed as a concept. And I was sitting there going, oh, that's really cool. But it didn't look great. And
it's not
and,
very you scary, know, is it?
It's not scary, I mean, yeah. No. It's like a cool design and like I like the idea of it. So it was interesting that he decided to not keep that kind of grainy feel. I mean, it's not like the first one was really grainy and actually felt 70s, but I still think there were longer takes and I don't know, it just felt more filmic rather than this feels more digital, for lack of a better word. Like, I don't know whether this was shot on film or not, or even if the first one was, but it felt like it. But yeah, I mean, technical stuff aside, I think it was still really effective. I was pretty freaked out at times, for sure. I think much like the first film, as it went on, I was less scared and more just enjoying the movie and enjoying the ride. But yeah, I was really, really happy with it overall. I thought the performances were good. And I actually really like, I hope he makes another one, because I like the idea of these two, this couple, Ed and Lorraine Warren, I want to say.
Yeah, I think it's Warren.
The paranormal investigators. Like, they're like paranormal Indiana Jones, a couple. Like, they always come back with like some artifact or something and like place it in their little, you know, scary room back at their house.
It's such a weird thing to do.
It's really strange, isn't it? I guess that's what they did in real life.
Yeah, maybe.
Like, and that's another element I like. I mean, I don't really, I'm not sitting there like believing all of this stuff, but I do like that they're like these people that just went on these like adventures in real life, apparently, you know, like all over the world and had these like crazy things happen to them. So I could watch like one of these every few years, honestly, just as a fun, kind of scary, you know, paranormal thing. If they're all like well made like this, for sure, I'd be up for seeing another one. But yeah, anyway, they're sort of my general thoughts. Hopefully that wasn't too rambly. I'm still waking up over here. Because I saw the movie yesterday and I must admit I was thinking of that nun last night. And it was a little scary.
Yeah, that was pretty freaky.
Yeah. What about you, Matt? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think I agree for the most part. I think it sounds like you perhaps liked it a little bit more than me, but I still quite enjoyed it as well. Mm-hmm. I think for me, there's probably a little too much reliance on jump scares. I was just kind of sitting there, especially towards the end, after, you know, the 28th jump scare had happened, and I kind of just missing, so, I mean, it's a completely different film, but just something like The Witch or something that doesn't do any of that, but is just builds like this utter sense of dread, which I didn't really feel in The Conjuring. Like, it's sort of like within the moment, he's good at building tension, but I never once sort of felt that any of the characters were in mortal danger, or maybe sort of some of the family members I did, but I never really cared enough about them to, you know, really, really feel freaked out. But he's, certainly effective scene to scene with just building creepiness. And like you said, with the nun, that was some of my favorite shit. Like the scene with the painting on the wall in the, in the study. Oh man.
Yeah. That I was like half covering my face in that scene, watching it. That was just, where the light keeps going off and the paint, like you just see the face and stuff. Yeah. That was really effective.
It's so, so well done. And that just the way it kind of, you're never 100% sure whether it's the painting or if it's an actual face there. Like it's really cool. And actually while I'm on a roll of talking about specific scenes, the other scene that I really loved, was the scene when they are sort of interviewing the girl, or not interviewing the girl, but they're trying to coax the creepy old man voice out of her, and she says she won't do it if they're not looking or whatever, so they all turn away.
Oh, that was amazing.
It's just this really, really long one take of what's his name? Patrick Wilson, is that his name? Close up and to the left of frame, and she is just out of focus. And kind of like weirdly, slightly deforming and getting a bit strange, and it's just and it holds that for the entirety of the scene, and like it never racks focus. You're always expecting it to like do some cheap scare or something to freak you out, but it just, it's so subtle and so well done. And
yeah, that was really, really effective.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it was so slow that it was like halfway through that shot, I realized that it was like, now there was a man sitting there. And then like, but I didn't realize it. I didn't see it happening. Like it was like really slow over the whole take. And that was, yeah, super effective.
Yeah. So, and there's just little things like that. Like I agree with you that it didn't necessarily feel 70s or old school to filmmaking, but that was, the filmmaking itself was my favorite part of this film.
Like, yeah,
I agree. It's just so fun to watch him play around. Like there's so many great sort of like jump cuts that aren't jump cuts. Like he hides. Yes. I mean, it's all digital trickery, but it's really well done. Like to her falling, the little girl falling over, and then she'll be in the like living room instead of in the bedroom, or it'll do like a zoom into her face and then zoom out and it'll be, she'll be somewhere else. And it was, yeah, it was really cool. I loved all that stuff. It was so much fun. So yeah, I guess like in general, more enjoyable than I anticipated, but I would agree that the longer it went on, I think it's a little over long too. Like I think it's over 2 hours, isn't it? I think it could have done with a bit of a tighten up. And the kind of the logic at the end of the film fell apart a little bit for me. But yeah, in general, it was, yeah, a pleasant surprise. And I do like your idea of them doing like a series of adventures of these spooky couple that goes and exercises demons or whatever. That's pretty cool. It's a cool idea.
Yeah, that would be really fun. And I was thinking of that, you know, when towards the end, when they probably around the part that you were saying, like it all falls apart a little bit. They've got this like riddle to solve for some reason. Yeah. The ghost gives them a riddle.
I know. Like what?
Yeah, that was kind of weird. But that's what triggered it in my head. It's like, oh, they're kind of like solving this like puzzle, and now they're going to go defeat the bad demon. And like I don't know. I really like the structure of like, they learn about it. They're hesitant to do it. They finally go, like, I don't care if it's the same thing every time. I find that really, just appealing as like a thrill ride kind of thing. Yeah. It's cool.
Yeah, it's funny that the whole sort of mystery in the third act, I think a lot of the parts on their own are quite cool and clever. Like I really loved the two audio recordings that when they played them, like taken at different times, when they played them simultaneously, it like they filled in the gaps and it became a full sentence. Like that's such a cool idea. But like you said, the actual logic of when they're putting all the pieces together, like that for some reason they needed the demon's name and the demon just told them the name, like
just told her earlier or whatever for some reason.
Weird. And then she just keeps the Bible that she like destroyed in the house just in the back of the car or whatever. Odd.
Yeah, that's a good point. I didn't think of that. Why would she keep that?
But yeah, I mean that's a little bit nitpicky, and it's kind of, you know, in it, not really about that, but it did take me out of it a little bit.
Yeah. That's a good sort of point to lead to. Like, do you think this is about anything? Is James Wan interested in using all this stuff as a metaphor for something, or is it more of just like a superficial carnival ride, haunted house, which is fine. I almost think it probably is more of that. I'm struggling to sort of think if there's anything there. What I did like was sort of halfway through, or I guess it's towards the third act, the final act, is that everyone thinks she's faking it. And, you know, we've seen enough as audience to know that it's real, but I like the idea of doing a movie like this and then it turns out that they are. And like, it's almost like an anticlimax at the end or something like that. Yeah. I know they'd never do it because it's quite a mainstream sort of movie by this point, but I don't know. I found that idea interesting, and of course they didn't go down it, but you know, a bit more questioning of what's real and what isn't would be something I'd be keen to explore in another movie if they do another one.
No, I think you're right in terms of the substance of the film. I don't think there is much there. It is kind of refreshing that he seems to be more interested in character than most horror films are. Which is a good thing, even though I don't think it's doing or saying anything particularly interesting, you know, but it does spend the time with the characters, or the lead characters, Lorraine and what's his name? What's the guy's name?
Ed.
Ed. Yeah. Yeah. Like their relationship is almost focused on more than the child.
Yeah. And her I like family. That.
Yeah. And it kind of just ends with them, you know, reconciling the issues that they were having and having a little dance in the living room or whatever.
That's right. Yeah.
Which is cool. I like that. But other than that, I don't think it's particularly interested in making any sort of big statements or exploring any sort of deeper themes.
Yeah. I mean, you can't expect something from a film like that you want that the filmmaker has no interest in. But, you know, it does also start with them on that show with a skeptic. And there's a skeptic with them, this woman, that's also investigating the case.
Mm.
And it just felt like maybe that was something they could have pushed even further. But yeah, the movie clearly is 100% on the side of the Warrens.
Yeah.
And I probably have done some research. I don't know if they're still around or not.
Yeah, I'm not sure actually.
But maybe to get permission to use the stories, they had to sort of, you know, say that, yeah, we won't make fun of you or something. I don't know.
We won't suggest that you're dodgy. No, I think it's a really good point. And I think I agree that it is a missed opportunity, particularly now that you bring that up. Like, there is a big through line about the skeptics and people who don't believe in what they're doing, but it never really goes anywhere. I mean, there's that moment where they all leave because, like, she's caught on video as faking it. But like you said, we as an audience never buy into that once. Like, it's almost pointless in a sense.
I found that scene a bit strange. Because, like, the doors all slammed shut in front of everyone and she didn't do that, you know? And then, like, they've all witnessed, like, shit moving at other times. Mm. It just felt a bit strange that they would, just give up so easily then.
Yeah.
But I guess they needed that, you know, dramatic tension or whatever.
In the trailer discussion, I mentioned one of the shots looked a little silly and funny. Did you find any moments in the film that didn't work or were unintentionally hilarious instead of frightening?
Not as much. No, when you finally get to that scene where she's like all contorted in that little cupboard, that was actually quite scary and effective. Mm. Like I said before, I think some of the CG stuff, it wasn't funny, but it wasn't scary either. At first I was a bit put off by that. When the dog turns into the crooked man or something. Yeah. I was like, oh, what's going on here? What are we turning into? But then I sort of really liked it just as a concept and as a design.
Yeah.
It wasn't particularly scary. I don't know. Did anything stand out to you as not working, or do you think it was all pretty effective?
No, it was all pretty well done, I think. Yeah, that scene in particular where she's all weirdly contorted into the cupboard or whatever it is. It worked surprisingly well when it was actually in the context of the film. I don't think that, I mean, there's little things. I agree with the crooked man, was an interesting visual idea, but wasn't scary. I kind of liked that it almost looked stop motion-y, like the movement and things. Like it was a cool idea. And having just praised the scene with the nun in the study and the paintings, there is the moment where sort of like the hands come out from behind the painting and it sort of just became a little bit CG and suddenly just lost all scary. It never became funny, but it was just so menacing, that sort of painting in the darkness. You didn't really need to push it any further than that. And
literally push it.
Yeah.
Push the painting.
it also got a little too magical in some points too, like when the little girl gets like pulled through the floor and things, like she's up on the roof and then she sort of just gets sucked up in like inside into the bedroom, and I don't know, like that took me out of the film a little bit just because it was so utterly unbelievable that I didn't quite understand the logic or the rules of the world at that point.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, that reminds me too of the end when they she beats the nun demon and it turns into this CG like horned thing for a second, and that was just not needed. It's like instantly not scary at all at that point.
Yeah.
But I mean that's nitpicky stuff, I suppose.
Yeah. Oh, actually, that just reminded me we can cut this out as well, but we were talking before about how the puzzle at the end didn't make sense. I did find it strange that, like, the whole conceit was that, well, like, the nun demon was, like, the one that was behind it all. She was the mastermind. It's kind of weird. And why did... If the nun demon's end goal was to, like, get break up this couple or kill, what's his name, old mate, Ed. Like, why go to London and like find this remote family so far away from the target that it's after, and like then on top of that, like the whole twist at the end is like the old bloke that carked it in the chair was actually just like a lovely old man that is being controlled by forced to do this stuff by the nun. Bullshit. Like, the stuff that came out of his mouth, he's like biting children and things. Like,
yeah, that's, exactly.
He was clearly not a nice person.
Prick. Yeah.
I thought that was a little bit hard to swallow when at first I was like, oh, that's a good twist. And then I thought about it for 1 second and was like, that makes no sense.
Yeah. I agree with that. And I don't know how much they're taking from what the real case was, but that is like where you start to go, I don't really believe most of this is real or true. And I mean, maybe all that the nun demon stuff was made up. Maybe in real life,
as in their reports,
they concluded that it was just the old man or something.
Yeah.
But yeah, all that other stuff's a bit too. It doesn't quite add up or make sense.
Mm. One other thing that I really liked is the opening titles. I'd forgotten.
Oh, like,
they're so cool. And I remember that from the first Conjuring when I saw it.
The
scrolling text and the big words just moving across the screen. And that's kind of it. I think there's ominous music playing at the...
Yeah, it's like really shrill kind of ominous music. Yeah. I love those titles. And I was the same. I'd forgotten how cool they were.
Yeah.
But then that does, even though we're both pretty positive on this movie, it is a shame that he didn't follow through with that filmmaking, you know, because that's very 70s. And he has a couple of freeze frames in the movie, which I really liked. Again, it kind of feels old school. But then there's really modern stuff at the same time. It's a bit of a strange mixture in that sense. And I do, as much as I like the movie, I am a little disappointed that it wasn't more classical in that sense. Mm.
Yeah, I would agree with that. It almost doesn't earn how good those opening titles are.
Yeah, with the rest they're of the so film. Good. Yeah.
We both seem like we're pretty positive overall. It was a decent sequel, a bit of a pleasant surprise, I suppose. And yeah, I love your idea of them being the Indiana Jones of horror films, especially if it's globetrotting like this. Like, it was cool that it was set in a completely different country, so
yeah, I'd certainly really like
be up for checking out another one of their adventures if they do make a third film.
Yeah me too. And before we go, I was gonna ask you, Matt, if I could Google this, but are you anywhere near Enfield?
Yeah, it is Enfield, and I have no idea. I don't think so, but I don't think it's too far away.
Go and see the house.
Yeah, I could.
Wise men say only fools rush in,
falling in love with you. Shall I
see? Thanks for listening to the PrePost film review. We'd love to know what you guys thought of The Conjuring 2. Did it stack up to the first movie, or was it disappointing? You can email us at prepostfilmreview@gmail.com, and we reply to every email. So you, even if you just type hello, we'll write hello back, which is nice.
And if you don't want to email us, you can also find us on Facebook. And we're also on Twitter. We're at PrePostFR. We post interesting news articles and little updates there, so come on over and check us out. The most important thing, however, is to subscribe. So head on over to iTunes and click the subscribe button. And if you're feeling generous, you can also leave us a review. That would be super awesome. Or you can just subscribe to us on whatever you're using to listen to this podcast right now. That would be great.
That's right. You can also follow us on Letterboxd, which is a great little film community website. The links to our profiles are in the show notes there. And it's just a great way to rank movies and see what else we've been watching and keep a diary of what you've been watching. So join us next episode. We're going to be talking about another sequel, Independence Day Resurgence.
Got nothing funny to add to that. I was trying to think of a weird noise to make, but couldn't come up with anything.
Life too, for I can't help falling in love with you. For I can't falling in love with you.
I think they're fighting. But I can't look here.
Do you know who they are?
No, it's just someone out on the street.
Well, maybe that's appropriate for the for this movie, if you've just got like these yelling voices in the background.
True.